This case takes place in the USA on the 22nd of October, 2013. Colleen Ritzer was a 24-year-old woman who lived in Massachusetts. She was described as bright from a very young age. She had two siblings and was incredibly close with her family. They would later say that she always had a smile on her face and was always positive. Growing up, Colleen realized her path almost immediately. She loved helping people and aimed to become a teacher when she got a little bit older. Colleen excelled in this path. Many said that it was almost like she was born to be a teacher, choosing math as her subject. Her colleague would later look back and state, "She was energetic and compassionate. You couldn't ask for anything more from a teacher and a friend. She cared about every single student, and she put in many hours after school every day, always thinking about how she could be better and to better help students. She truly was a beautiful person." In October of 2013, Colleen was in her second year of teaching maths at Danvers High School. At this point, she was 24 years old, and she lived at home with her parents Peggy and Tom Ritzer. Every day after finishing work, Colleen would return home, usually by 3:30 p.m. She would sit on the sofa, planning the upcoming lessons for her class. She took her career extremely seriously, and she enjoyed it very much. The morning of the 22nd of October 2013 was Dress Like Your Friend Day at the school. Colleen chose to dress like her friend and colleague Sarah. Colleen arrived before 7 a.m. She taught a number of classes, and that day, Colleen was to finish up her last lesson, which would end at 1:55 p.m. In this final class was a student named Philip Chisholm, a name that would soon become infamous in the country. Philip was a 14-year-old freshman at Danvers High School, and he had recently moved from Tennessee. Since starting at the school, Philip had been doing relatively well. There were no real behavioral issues, and he had made a couple of friends. He also excelled in sport, particularly the freshman football team, or soccer if you're American or Australian. On this day, Philip attended Colleen's final math lesson of the day. According to those in the class, everything seemed normal. There was no evidence of any prior hostility whatsoever between Philip and Colleen. Other teachers who taught Philip that day would later say that he seemed totally ordinary, but some of his friends would say that he was a little more quiet than usual. The mathematics class ended at 1:55 p.m. In the school, there was a set amount of time allocated for students to stay behind and work with teachers if they were struggling with anything in particular, or if they just needed any help at all. With Colleen, two students stayed behind on this occasion. One was a freshman named Autumn. Autumn didn't need any help, she just came by as she wanted to see her favorite teacher, and the other student was Philip. When Autumn entered the classroom, they saw Philip and Colleen talking. Autumn drew on the whiteboard whilst she overheard the two talking. Philip was telling Colleen where he was from before moving to the school, and she asked him if he missed Tennessee. According to Autumn, Colleen was being very polite, but Philip seemed to be somewhat annoyed by her questions. He began mumbling responses at her and had a strange demeanor. For a moment, Colleen exited the classroom. She can be seen on CCTV doing so. She spoke with a friend and colleague, the one that she was dressing as for the day. The two spoke outside the classroom briefly about various things. She said that one of her students, Autumn, was just drawing on the board inside. She went on to say that Philip was also in there too, and she had no idea what he wanted or why he was staying behind. But inside the classroom, Philip approached Autumn. His demeanor had changed. He no longer seemed angry, and he was no longer mumbling. He told Autumn that she was good at drawing, and he asked her for her name. Autumn told Philip her name, and he took the pen from her hands and wrote her name on the board in Chinese. Colleen then returned to the classroom and told Philip and Autumn that she needed to head home soon. Philip didn't seem to get the hint. He instead sat down at a desk right near Colleen's desk. Autumn, on the other hand, began to leave. She said goodbye to her, and as she did, she gave Colleen a compliment. Autumn noticed that as she did this, Philip seemed visibly angry. Confused by his anger, she exited the classroom, leaving Philip and Colleen alone. Security footage then shows Colleen exit the classroom. She made her way to the girls' bathroom, and moments after she does this, Philip too emerges. He can be seen checking his pockets while looking in Colleen's direction and following her towards the direction of the bathroom. As he was following Colleen, he put on some white gloves. Colleen entered the bathroom, and Philip caught up. He paused momentarily before entering the room. He was making sure that no one was around, and that Colleen was alone inside. As Philip entered, he grabbed Colleen and covered her mouth. Philip asphyxiated Colleen and began forcing himself upon her. As this was happening, another student just so happened to enter the bathroom. As she walked in, she saw the naked buttocks of what she believed to be a dark-skinned female student. The student simply assumed that someone was getting changed, and she didn't want to interrupt them. She also didn't see any blood, and she didn't see Colleen. So with that, she backed away and left the bathroom, thinking absolutely nothing of it. This student went to another part of the building and did some homework. The attack continued inside the bathroom. That day, Philip had brought with him a box cutter. With this blade, he began to viciously hack at Colleen's throat. 11 minutes after entering the bathroom, Philip can be seen leaving on CCTV. He was seen carrying her black trousers over his arms, with blood on his right hand. Philip walked down the hallway, down the stairs, and exited the building. He went and retrieved a school bin and wheeled it to the elevator and made his way back to the bathroom where he had killed Colleen. As he was doing so, Philip bumped into a fellow football team member. The team member asked what he was doing with the bin. Philip replied, "Nothing," and told his teammate that he would soon see them at football practice. The two said bye, and Philip walked on, eventually entering the girls' bathroom. He picked up Colleen's body and placed her inside the wheelie bin. He closed the lid and wheeled Colleen's body out of the school grounds, towards a wooded area behind the school. Here, Philip removed Colleen's clothing. He then proceeded to insert a tree branch into Colleen's genitals. He also used the box cutter again to further slice Colleen's throat. Philip spent 25 minutes in the woods before leaving. He covered Colleen's body up with leaves and left items around the area. He left his backpack, two white gloves, two socks, and a folded note which read, "I hate you all." Philip returned to the school with his jeans stained with Colleen's blood. He grabbed some of his things from his locker, changed in some different clothing, and re-entered the second floor girls' bathroom for a minute before finally leaving the school. On the way, Philip then bumped into a fellow student. This student would later say that he seemed totally calm and was acting normal. It seems that Philip was not at all fazed by the horrific crime he had just committed. Meanwhile, of course, Colleen had not returned home at 3:30 like she usually would. Her parents realized immediately. After more time passed, they tried to contact her, but there was no response. Colleen's family reported her missing to the police. Around the same time, Philip's family also reported him missing. He had not attended football practice, which was unusual, and he had not returned home after school. The school became aware that Philip and Colleen were missing, and they realized that Philip was in Colleen's last session of the day. All of Colleen's possessions were missing from the classroom, but her car was still in the parking lot. After Philip left the school, he walked to a Wendy's and used Colleen's credit card to buy some food for himself, purchased a hunting knife from a store, and went to a movie theater to go and see a film. Meanwhile, the police were busy looking for Colleen and Philip. Shortly after midnight, Philip was found. He was seen walking along a tree line in a narrow area of Route 1, an area that pedestrians don't usually walk. At first, officers didn't realize who he was, but they pulled over to see if he was okay. The officers asked him where he was heading to, but Philip avoided all eye contact and simply said, "Nowhere." When they asked where he lived, Philip gave no address. The police decided to search Philip, as they were concerned about his suspicious behavior. They pulled out a driver's license, credit cards, and an insurance card, all in the name of Colleen Ritzer. At this moment, the officers weren't aware that she was missing. Philip told the officers that he had gotten the cards from her. At this point, Philip decided to give his name. The police were greatly relieved. They hadn't heard that a teenager named Philip Chisholm was missing. They were happy that he was found safe and sound. Philip was allowed to sit in the police car to keep warm, but first they wanted to check out his red satchel. However, the police soon realized why Philip was acting in such a strange manner. In the bag were more of Colleen's belongings, keys, makeup, and her blood-stained underwear. A box cutter was also found inside the bag, and the blade was covered in Colleen's blood. Philip told the police where the blood was from, simply saying, "It's the girls." It's at this point that Philip was arrested. The police were disturbed and concerned, and they asked where Colleen was. Philip bluntly replied, "She's buried in the woods." Officers asked if they could help her if they got to her. Philip replied, "No." Before Philip was found, Colleen's family had been searching for her into the night, desperately concerned for their daughter. Colleen's colleagues, friends, and the police were out looking for her. News was then shared that Philip had been found and arrested. At the station, Philip agreed to tell the police exactly where they could find Colleen's body. At 3 a.m., a forensic scientist and a paramedic were searching the woods when they came across a toe with pink nail polish protruding from some leaves. The pair uncovered Colleen's body. Dirt and debris were found in her eyes and airway. Colleen was pronounced dead at the scene. When Philip was asked why he had killed Colleen, he said very little. He told them that he decided to kill her after she said a trigger word, but he refused to explain further as to what this specific trigger word actually was. The police questioned Philip further as to whether the motive was sexual. Philip responded by saying no, assuring the police that there was no SA involved. This, however, would soon be found to be an outright lie. The news of the murder spread quickly. Those who loved Colleen and those who she had taught just couldn't believe that anyone would ever want to do this to her. She wouldn't hurt a fly, and she wasn't the type of person to have any enemies. An autopsy was conducted on Colleen's body, sperm cells were recovered, and the DNA was shown to be Philip's. As I mentioned earlier, Philip had repeatedly stabbed and sliced Colleen's neck with a box cutter. So much so that those conducting the autopsy couldn't determine how many times Philip had applied the box cutter to her neck. It was evident that the attack was of a horrifically gruesome nature, one typically seen in crimes of passion, where the killer is fueled by extreme rage. But this was a beloved teacher, a teacher who had no conflict with Philip. The autopsy reports indicated that it was hard to tell exactly what killed Colleen, but it does seem that she was killed by asphyxiation. CCTV footage of the school hallway began surfacing. The footage is incredibly haunting to see once the context is fully explained and understood. It shows a young man with incredibly sinister intentions before and after committing a truly vile crime. A few days after the tragic murder, a meeting was held at Danvers High School, where the police and educational authorities spoke with the parents.
We're also working the very latest on a shocking high school homicide. Classes are going to resume today at Danvers High School following the death of a popular teacher, 24-year-old Colleen Ritzer, allegedly at the hands of one of her teen students. Nearly 1,000 parents attended a meeting at the school last night aimed at answering questions as to how to help their students cope when they return to school today.
I think a lot of us are at a loss for how we're supposed to deal with it, like what we're supposed to do, what we're not supposed to do.
Most of the building will be open today, except for the bathroom where Ritzer was attacked. That is going to remain blocked off since it is still considered a crime scene.
They assured the parents that their children were not in any form of danger. Over 1,000 adults attended this meeting. The parents were of course deeply affected by the murder, but they were also extremely sympathetic towards the parents of Philip. One parent said, "Essentially, two families lost children. You've got to remember that to his parents, he is still their kid. He is involved in a terrible tragedy, but he is still their kid. You have to sympathize with them. They must be going through hell at this moment." Due to his age, Philip was to be tried as an adult. During the court proceedings, Philip was asked whether he was going forward as guilty or not guilty. Philip chose to plead not guilty.
Yes.
Would you please rise? Philip Chisholm, on indictment number 2013-1446-001, charging on the 22nd day of October 2013 in Danvers, in the County of Essex, did assault and beat Colleen Ritzer with the intent to murder her, and by such assault and beating, did kill and murder said Colleen Ritzer. What say you, sir, to this indictment? Guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty.
Not guilty. Counsel, you waive the formal reading to the additional indictments?
Yes, I do.
Philip Chisholm, counsel, having waived the formal reading, pleas of not guilty are entered on your behalf on number 13,
YO. While Philip was awaiting trial, he was held in a youth detention center. During his incarceration, he attacked a service worker. On the 2nd of June 2014, Philip followed a service worker into the bathroom. He choked the woman, punched her, and attacked her with a sharpened pencil. Thankfully, the woman was able to escape, and Philip was restrained. But as he was being restrained, he screamed out, "I'm going to kill them all." The victim of this attack would later say, "His face still haunts me. The lack of any emotion, just ready to kill. Sometimes I wake out of a deep sleep, panting, fighting my way out of a chokehold that isn't currently happening. Sometimes tears well up in my eyes unexpectedly, reminding me of how scared I was, and still am, that he will come for me again. True monsters do exist in this world. Philip Chisholm is a monster, a murderer. My recommendation to the courts is that he remain in prison for the rest of his life, locked away, without the means to hurt another person." Following this attack, Philip was charged with attempted murder on top of his murder charge. It became blatantly clear that Philip was a true danger to society. The trial would officially begin in 2015. Philip's defense lawyer began by acknowledging the pain Colleen's family and friends must be suffering during this time, before calling Philip Chisholm a kind and smart 14-year-old. The defense lawyer said that Philip took a wonderful person from this world, but that he only did it because of a serious mental illness. Before the trial, Philip was evaluated by a number of mental health professionals. The defense stated that Philip was suffering from an acute psychotic episode brought on by early-onset schizophrenia when he killed Colleen. One of these mental health professionals was Richard Dudley. He diagnosed Philip after a number of meetings the two had. He told the courts that Philip was hearing aggressive auditory hallucinations, perhaps since he was 10 years old. He argued that the undiagnosed illness, compounded with the grief of moving from Tennessee, caused a psychotic break, triggered by Colleen asking Philip where he had moved from. However, there were other doctors who had evaluated Philip who disagreed with these findings. Dr. Kinscherf firmly believed that Philip was not suffering from a mental disease or defect on the date of the offense. He interviewed Philip for a total of 13 hours, and he said that Philip never appeared to be impaired, and that he even seemed to be faking some symptoms. A few other doctors came to the same conclusion. They didn't believe that Philip had a psychotic break. They believed that he was just a cold-blooded killer. The prosecution highlighted a number of reasons as to why the murder wasn't due to a psychotic break. First of all, Philip had brought with him a number of items he used to kill Colleen, showing a degree of premeditation. Why would he have brought these items, such as a large box cutter, gloves, etc., if the murder was not premeditated? The claim that he only killed Colleen because she mentioned Tennessee to him was therefore invalid and just didn't make any sense. As mentioned earlier, Philip had used a tree branch to violate Colleen's body with. During the trial, Philip was acquitted of penetrating Colleen with the tree branch, but this wasn't based on any findings that Philip did not inflict the penetration. Rather, it was because Colleen was not alive at the time of the penetration. Under Massachusetts law, the victim must be alive when such an act is committed for the perpetrator to be found guilty of SA. Although, Philip was found guilty of the murder of Colleen, and the court didn't accept that he was insane at the time of the case taking place. Before the sentencing, the family of Colleen read out victim impact statements.
As Colleen's mom, her voice in this room, I urge you to impose the maximum sentence allowed to you under the restrictive SJC ruling. These sentences must be consecutive. They cannot be concurrent, as these crimes are separate and distinct, and the impact that each has had on our family is truly indescribable. You must remember that after he committed these brutal crimes, he calmly left and got himself dinner and went to a movie. You watched him calmly walk around the school on the video from DHS. But throughout this trial, he would often be described as staring into space. However, you watched him, as did I, how intently he paid attention to himself on that video. He did not shy away from watching it. He watched every clip of it with great attention and absolutely no remorse. When that video was broadcast, he was the most alive in this courtroom, including during Ms. McDougal's closing. He never once flinched or showed any sign of remorse or guilt. On August 11th, 2013, Colleen shared on social media, "No matter what happens in life, be good to people. Being good to people is a wonderful legacy to leave behind." And on October 5th, 2013, she shared, "Every day may not be good, but there is something good in every day. This is the person that Colleen was and continues to be. And although I struggle that my 24-year-old daughter has a legacy, I am honored at what that legacy is and proud to be her mother. Today, the good must prevail over the evil. You need to remember that Colleen matters. Thank you for the opportunity to share with you who Colleen is and the impact her loss has had and continues to have on my family."
Thank you.
Philip Chisholm was sentenced to life in prison, but will be eligible for parole after serving 40 years, a decision that greatly upset and angered Colleen's family. Philip was given the maximum possible sentence for someone of his age, but many found his potential release a terrifying prospect.
"Although this individual parole amounts to cruel and unusual punishment for Colleen's loved ones,
our family will be forced to attend parole hearings beginning in 38 years. Which is simply unimaginable to us."
A different kind of pain for Chisholm's own mother, who broke down in the courtroom. She left without a word, her now 17-year-old son unable to seek parole until age 54.
A professor of psychiatry at Harvard Medical School said that such cases were off the charts rare, and went on to say, "I personally have never seen anything like this in the thousands of cases I have supervised. The case of Colleen is truly despicable, but before I end the video, I would like to mention a couple of things. To get a better insight as to who Colleen was as a person, you can watch a short documentary. It includes interviews from her family, friends, and students, and demonstrates the life and legacy of Colleen Ritzer and her impact as a teacher. The video is incredibly touching, and it will be linked in the comments. Second of all, there is a website which hosts her memorial fund. This organization helps people get into teaching and has raised thousands of dollars. A link to this organization will also be pinned in the comments, and a portion of the ad revenue for this video will be donated to the fund. One post on this website states, "When remembering Colleen's life, the message is clear. She was good to people, she taught with inspiration, and that was her legacy.